Good afternoon, dear students. Thank you very much for your time that you came to this video conference. My name is Nina, and as you already know, I am borrowed in this program. So I just helping Elsa Morocho. So I will try to do my best in helping you with these main points of this course. Well, since this subject has a lot of material, a lot of information, I am going to do a kind of city tour. Everything. A little bit of everything, but in not very extended form. Well, so for time's sake, I think we have to begin. Well, so teachers and teaching. So you know that we teachers are the main protagonists of any teaching and any courses. So it puts some demands on us. Like for example, teachers are supposed to have a command of English, not just knowledge of grammar rules. Well, and also use English most of time, including beginner classes. Now you know that it's quite possible. So it will speak about successful teachers. Yeah, so if you want to be a successful teacher, you try to follow these suggestions. Well, and another is think mostly in terms of students' practice and not teacher explanations. I understand that we teachers tend to speak too much during class, but we also have to give chance to our students to speak too. Well, and successful teachers also find time for really communicative activities, not just practice of language forms, inject some practicing, some games, some role plays, and to make teaching more interesting and attractive for students, and not just focusing on finishing the syllables of course book like in majority of educational establishments teachers do. Yeah, they just focus on finish the course, that's all. Well, and before we begin any course in any educational establishment, private or government, we always have to establish goals, yeah, and objectives in teaching and learning. Well, so this is the primary first thing we have to do, think about goals, establish short-term and long-term goals. Well, when we have this clearly established goals or outputs, what we want to achieve in our course, so it will be easier for us to adapt our teaching accordingly and to design and design our class activities and the methods used in class that all go toward the established goals. Well, and but the main goal of teaching English is achieve good results. And how can you define what is good result? It's for example, when our students pay attention in class, when they show clear interest toward you are explaining in class, they listen carefully, and to my opinion, the most important is when they ask questions. Yeah, sometimes when you teacher you finish a class and say, do you have questions? No questions? So you have to think about this, whether teacher students didn't understand anything, or maybe everything was so clear. But anyway, asking and answering questions is an indicator that you achieved a good result. Well, and of course, active participation. Well, and methodology. So this name of our course, it's methodology. So what methodology is? It's basically methodology refers to teaching, showing what is teaching, showing or helping someone to learn how to do something, giving instructions, guiding in the study of something, and providing with knowledge and causing to learn. This is the definition I took from the dictionary. Well, so method is a plan for presentation of language material. What I would like to say before I continue, that all methods are too prescriptive, and they are distinctive at early stage and rather indistinguishable from each other at later stages. And if you ask a question, which method is the best? So maybe I have to disappoint you, but there is no the perfect method. Well, but just combination of all methods may give you a perfect methodology, perfect procedure in class that may lead to success. Well, so There is no best method. You have to adapt your teaching according to situation, according to needs of your students. Well, and so be flexible enough and maybe switch from one method to another if you see that chosen method for this particular class is not giving good results. So you have to adapt your teaching. Well, and I'm going to briefly focus on methods that are established or designed by main teacher for this course. And the first one is grammar translation method. As you already know, grammar translation is one of the first methods that was used in teaching of foreign languages. I would call it like grandfather of all methods. Well, and so why grammar translation? Grammar translation was chosen as a basis for teaching foreign languages. You know that in medieval ages or middle ages, the only foreign language used was Latin. It was a language of education, language of court, language used by educated society, and it was taught using just translation from Latin into target language and vice versa. So there was no concrete methodological explanation of procedure how to do this. So people, when there was a need to learn more foreign languages, they simply decided to follow the same established procedure like in learning Latin language. Yeah, so it was grammar translation. Well, and it dominated European language teaching almost 100 years. Well, so in this slide you have some main characteristics that you already know. This characteristic that first, it's its name suggests, grammar and translation. So it's focused on teaching, learning grammar rules and simply applying this knowledge of grammar rules in translation from and into target language. Well, so goal is to learn language in order to read the target language. This is the main goal. And a characteristic also that you, as you already know, I am sure that you know that this method is used teaching, using a mother language. So there is no need for teacher to be efficient in target language. I mean, in its spoken form, just enough a teacher has a good mastery of grammar and of course in vocabulary, so in order to be able to assist your students when translating. Well, and grammar is taught deductively by presentation and study of grammar rules. Well, and as you already know, this is the basic characteristic of this method, that there is no attention given to pronunciation. So speaking and pronunciation is absolutely not emphasized. And also, what else I would like to say, that vocabulary is learned in isolation. This is quite challenging for students to memorize the huge amount of vocabulary, vocabulary that is not grouped together. So, and now you know that, for example, when you teach any course, English course in general English, you open any book of teaching English in general English, you see that units are organized by topics. For example, topic unit number one, it's presentation, personal, how to introduce yourself. Topic number two, for example, speaking about daily routines. Well, and vocabulary and topics and vocabulary is organized around the topic. If it's presentation, so introducing forms, greeting, how we can greet each other, etc. If it's a personal introduction, so my name is, I'm, how old you are you, etc., etc. Or if, for example, next unit it's about past events, so we use past tense forms, etc. But in grammar translation, this was absolutely absent. So when students opened a book and they found unknown words, they had to copy on a list of words. And as you can see, that these lists were not grouped according to categories. So it was quite challenging to learn, memorize all these isolated words. It was quite challenging. Actually, this represents one of the negative points. of this method. And what I would like to say is that how methodology developed itself. Linguist or a pedagogue decides that something should be done with teaching, and he decides to create or design a method. So he thinks about some points, and these points are useful and practical at some stage. But later, these points may lead to some negative aspects, and it leads as a result to the declination of this method. And this is what happened with the grammar translation method. At first, it was kind of productive. Students learned grammar rules. They learned how to translate from and into target language. But due to so many negative points, like no emphasis on pronunciation and speaking, learning of vocabulary in isolation, so all this led to declination of this method, and it gave created sense of frustration in students. Well, and in addition, there is no specific literature how to develop subsequent education, subsequent teaching using just this method. So it was not justified. Methodology was not justified. Also, it led to declination of this method. Well, it's because there is no concrete methodology how to teach. Just, and in addition, it makes few demands on teachers. It's not necessary for teacher to be trained. It just what it's necessary to bring a good book and good dictionary, that's all. Well, but not everything is so bad. We also may so we also have to emphasize some positive aspects, and like this, for example, it's useful in the situations where understanding of text is the main focus of foreign language study. And if you remember our last chat, and this is what you, my dear students, you told me, you wrote me that it can be useful when there is no need to emphasize speaking or communication. For example, professionals, they need to understand updated literature, so they need just to know how to understand or need to know a big amount of vocabulary in order to be able to understand updated literature for their subject, for their profession field. Also, what is good that anybody who has a good master of a language can use this method in teaching in no special material. Well, and also it can be useful nowadays in large classes. For example, when you have, well, it's not a case of Ecuador, but I would like with this respect to mention that I had a colleague from India, and when I followed a course in Oregon University, so and we exchanged our experiences, and I said, well, sometimes it's difficult to teach in big class, and he said, Nina, what for you is a large class? I said, okay, large class, maybe 30 students, it's a large class. So he laughed and said, well, actually in India a large class is like 100 students, so this is a large class. Well, so in this situation, when the class is extremely large, this method also can be used, for example, to keep your students busy, to make them busy translating. Yeah, so this is can be what I would like to say about very briefly, of course, about grammar translation. Well, and as I mentioned, that each method emphasized something good, but some negative points led to declination of this method and gave basis for appearance of subsequent methods. And as a step between appearance of subsequent methods and methods in grammar translation was the so-called reform movement. So people who were participants of this reform movement, they basically they were pedagogues. I am sure that you already know, just briefly to remind you, that they just thought about that something should be done with teaching. So if I need to learn a foreign language and I need to speak this language, to use it in spoken form, so how I have to use speaking if I don't have a model to follow? So we need to learn phonology, we need to know pronunciation, and for pronunciation we need to know how sounds are pronounced and how they are described. Well, and as a result of this reform movement, it was outlined the study of spoken language is priority. And another result of this reform movement was appearance of international phonetic alphabet. Now it's so easy. We just open a dictionary. We don't know how to pronounce word, but we see basic phonetic symbols and we know approximately how this word can be pronounced. So it's thanks to reform movement, and it was like a response to the needs of learners of foreign languages to be able to communicate effectively in foreign languages. Well, you have this information. I'm not going to stop on it because you will have access to this presentation later. So if you need to learn again, you will have this information available. So this is, for time's sake, I have to fly so fast. And now I am going to focus very briefly again on direct method. Well, direct method, it was like answer to necessity of speaking ability that needs to be developed. It was absolutely in contrast, totally in contrast with grammar translation method. If you know the main points of direct method, so it's totally different from it, because direct method, it's just speaking. Well, very briefly, how it appeared, it was designed by Charles Berlitz in the 1880, as you see, so this method is also quite old. Well, and Charles Berlitz, he analyzed once, he saw his little boy son speaking and following, repeating some words after mom, and it made him realize, well, how my son is learning a language, native language, how is, he doesn't use, my wife, she doesn't use a dictionary nor grammar books to teach my little son to speak a language. So what makes my son to learn language efficiently? By following model that his mom provided. Yeah, so this was a basis for this method, just to following a model. That's why this method is called natural or naturalistic method. It's like child language acquisition. It was taken as a basis, acquisition of children, their first language. So, yeah, I'm sure that you already learned and studied your textbook, and you already know main points and in the guide designed by Elsa. Well, that the main point of this method is just speaking. It's exchange of conversation between teacher and students. It's based on answers and questions. Well, and everyday vocabulary is taught. And oral communication is organized around question and answer exchange. And concrete vocabulary is taught through demonstrations, pictures, and objects. In our last chat, we already emphasized that this method is suitable basically for beginners, because only basic things, basic concepts, and basic notions can be shown in pictures and explained through demonstrations. Well, so you already know this. And here you have some characteristics. Listening and speaking emphasis is absolutely opposed. It's completely opposed to grammar translation, where it emphasizes just speaking. Well, and here you have some principles of direct method. And these principles of direct method, we may agree on some of them and may disagree. For example, never translate, demonstrate. Up to some point, it's quite okay, but it can be used again just with when we refer to something very basic, something very simple. Well, never explain act. Again, if you want to show that you are thirsty or explain words like swimming, walking, you can do. But if you want to explain notion of friendship, it's kind of difficult to explain it just by body language, etc. Well, but there are some principles that are still very useful and practical. For example, never imitate mistakes. Correct. This is excellent principle of this method. And actually, I'd like you to take it and use it. What I want to say, When you in your classes, when you hear a student making mistakes, how do you usually correct this mistake? You say, no, Juanito, it's not correct to say this, you have to say that. Or how do you do it? Well, and the best way probably, well, not best, but one of the more appropriate ways to say not emphasizing mistakes, but simply provide correct form. This is a very good point, because if you say, no, it's not okay to say she can to play, it's okay to say she can play, and be sure that when you repeat this, it's not okay to say she can to play, so it will your students will more remember this rather than correct form. So never imitate, mistake correct. This is a principle that I would like to emphasize it. Well, and the rest of principles, we can agree, we can disagree, but for example, never use your book, use your lesson plan. Well, up to some point, it's okay. We always have to use a lesson plan, but sometimes it's not very practical, never use your book, because, you know, we have to know how we have to organize our lesson in what is the topic of my class today. If I don't look at the book, don't know what I'm going to do today, so my class will be chaotic and not very well planned. But at the same time, use your lesson plan. Sometimes is not may not work efficiently. For example, if you see that your students have demonstrate a lack of knowledge or lack of mastery of some points that were explained previously in last classes, so it's pointless to continue explaining your topics without reinforcing what your students don't know. Some teachers say, ah, I don't have time for this, they don't know, it's their problem. I think it's not a good attitude. Well, it's my personal opinion. I think it's not a very good attitude. In this case, we always have to stop and provide students extra explanation and reinforce the knowledge until they show or demonstrate they already have enough knowledge of that material, and now your teacher can go forward and continue with the next topic. Well, you will have this points and analyze. Well, limitations, very briefly. So limitations are several, like for example, it's sometimes it's quite difficult to always imitate without avoiding completed translation. Well, and another limitation is that sometimes it's not always possible to get a very highly trained teachers that have fluency or native-like pronunciation, so it's quite difficult to be a good model. So there are of course some good points, and like here you have high motivation. First of all, why high motivation? Because in a direct method, your students start speaking from the very first 5 minutes of your class. You when you apply this method, you come to say you come to class and say hello, and students repeat hello. Well, they already are using a native language. Great, high motivation. Well, in grammar translation, for example, no, they have to memorize rules, they have to learn vocabulary. But here, they in this method, in direct method, they simply follow model provided by a teacher. So motivation is extremely high. They started speaking from the very beginning. Well, so well, and then you have a methods error. Probably I'm going to skip this point for time's sake, but you will have this presentation available. I repeat again, so you can look at it and understand it, I hope. But very briefly, I would like to explain the difference between what is the difference between method, approach, and procedure. Well, very briefly, what is method? Maybe I'm going to use an example. You go to a doctor, for example, a person is sick and goes to a doctor. Well, and doctor, in order to heal this or to cure this disease, doctor has to use a concrete method, concrete methodology to apply to for this specific patient to cure him. Well, and he prescribes some medicine. So it's a design. He prescribes some medicine. And then we have a procedure. And so procedure basically refers to techniques. So what I want to say, method. Teacher, student, sorry, I have my cables came together. Well, so a patient needs to cure from this disease, so he has to follow prescription method. Yeah, prescription, and prescription establishes you need to take 3 times a day this concrete pill. Well, but how you do this? You can take this pill with juice or with water or with milk. So it's up to you. It's the same. It's which technique we use in class. Yeah, so approach, sorry, method, it's something like a global, it's a global form. Something in my teaching, what method I am going to use? I am going to use something concrete that is established, like, for example, direct method, no mother language, etc., etc. But how I can do this? I can do it using by different techniques. I can apply, for example, role plays. Or I can apply exchange of brief opinions, or we can use description. So description. So it's basically and very briefly how to understand the difference between method, approach, and procedure. So approach, how I am going to do this. Technique is basically activity, what I am going to use. It's how I am going to use this, what kind of technique I'm going to apply in my classes. Well, so next method to discuss is audiolingual method. In spite of this method, it's quite, well, not so new, but in spite of it, it's still very practical and useful nowadays. Well, because it emphasizes speaking, you know, it emphasizes speaking and automatic repetition of some grammar structures. Well, maybe a little bit of background of this method. It appeared because of the need for American Army to learn foreign languages very quickly as a part of its overall military operations around the world. So American soldiers, they were there was a need for them to be trained quickly in different languages. So teachers in University of Michigan designed this method in late 50s, and the basis of this method constituted emphasis on patterns, grammar patterns in the target language, and feedback in the reinforcement of positive results. For example, if students follow some model, and when they achieve native-like pronunciation, so this will be highly praised, and so it served as a stimuli and reinforcement. Well, so this method of language teaching is also known as oral method. So it's just speaking is emphasized. This method is said to result in rapid acquisition of speaking and listening skills. Why? Because it emphasizes automatic repetition without thinking, just automatic repetition of the same pattern. How can I get to that place? How can I get to Central Plaza? How can I get to museum? How can I get to, you see? So the same pattern is repeated until students achieve or repeat it automatically without even thinking that to make a question we have to organize using first a question word, then I have to use auxiliary. No, these explanations are not necessary when we apply this method. We just provide a model, a structure, it's a pattern, and students have to follow this without thinking much why. Yeah, so this is basically how this method works. So what with this regard I'd like to emphasize that students are expected to achieve fluency. Maybe they overlearn language, overlearn what it means. They are maybe stuffed with so many grammar patterns until they know them by heart, yeah, using just their memory. So principles, emphasis on having students produce error-free utterances, perfect, almost perfect utterances, and only everyday vocabulary and sentences are taught. It's similar to direct method, you see. Well, concrete vocabulary also is taught through demonstrations, objects, and pictures. It's also, it took as a basis from direct method, as I already said, that one method gives basis for another one. Yeah, so these elements were taken from direct method and applied in, were adopted by audiolingual method. Well, also, Use of native language is highly discouraged, the same as indirect method. Structured patterns in language are taught using repetitive drills. Yeah, so here we have goals to create communicative competence in learners. Very automatic production, correct, native-like pronounced utterances in target language. Well, and new material is presented in dialogue form, similar to grammar translation, similar to direct method. Structural patterns also taught using through repetitive drills, and vocabulary is limited, and new words are learned in context, not in isolation. This is different from grammar translation, but it's similar to direct method. And as in a direct method, also correct pronunciation and grammar are emphasized. Well, so here we have some classroom activities, drilling, repetition, dialogues, memorization, and imitation. I'm really sorry for this point, for this unforeseen stop. Well, so activities we have drilling, dialogues, and repetition, and memorization. Of course, these grammar patterns must be memorized by heart until the students are able to produce them automatically. Well, students hear a modal dialogue, and students repeat each line of the dialogue. Well, and with this regard, I'd like to specify some more details about class activities. And you can see that these class activities, and that this method can be used nowadays, as I already mentioned, because these activities can be useful even if you don't apply audiolingual method in any method. But this some parts of these activities can be used in many other method. For example, a chain drill. As you know, the drilling constitutes the main point of this method. So chain drill, for example, chain of conversation forms around the room, and the teacher greets or questions the student, and the student's response, the turn to the next student, etc., etc. And maybe this activity is not new, and maybe you can use it even in your classes without realizing that it originally it was a part of audiolingual method. For example, I like milk. Next student say, I like coffee. And next student say, I like milk, she likes coffee, but I like orange juice. Yeah, so this is a chain drill. This is a typical activity usually teachers can do as a warm-up activity. Well, so then we have next activity, it's so-called alphabet game. Well, you then may learn in more detail this activity. I am not going to stop on each activity, you will analyze later. Flashcards also, it's a very useful and practical activity, and this originally originally appeared in direct method, and audiolingual method adopted this also. The flashcards, pictures, realia, all these can be used in class. And also backward build up, it's another activity that you will analyze later in detail, in details. And more drilling, transformation drill. For example, when you have a model, but students have to replace some part. For example, transformation drill. When you present days of the week, you may say, I go to school on Monday. Yeah, and what do you do on Tuesday? Another activity. Yeah, so this is just students have to transform some part of information, or complete a dialogue. Also, it's a kind of activity. And this is an example. Actually, it was the reason why I made it stop, because I have it in my flash, but I didn't have it in my computer, so I had to find my flash and replace it. So this chain drill, this is an example how it works, how this activity is done in concrete way. You have an example. And this is a concrete example of a transformation drill, how students can transform some information in pattern provided by a teacher. And there is also so-called single slot substitution, when students are expected to substitute just one part of an utterance. Well, or also there is multiple slot substitutions, etc. Many type of drills activities. Well, And this use of minimal pairs also it's a practical activity, not to introduce a vocabulary, but especially it's practical when you introduce pronunciation. Yeah, like for example, make a contrast between p and b sounds. Yeah, so this is also part of this method. Well, and as you know, that each method has a different purpose. Some methods are focused on teacher. So they are called teacher-centered, and some methods are called learner-centered methods. Well, audiolingual is teacher-centered method. Why? Because teacher is the main protagonist of the class, because teacher provides a model, teacher provides a pattern for students to repeat, so that's why it is teacher-centered methods. Students simply are passive, well, up to some point, of course, passive participants, because this method does not does not require creativity on the part of students. Well, and language laboratory, of course, is obvious, it's necessary. Well, here in this slide, you have a basic difference between direct method and audiolingual. A method that, for example, in audiolingual method, students first hear language, but in direct method, and then they speak. But in direct method, they directly start speaking. Well, and some more differences that you may analyze it in a more tranquil form at home. Well, so positive points of this method that practice makes perfect. So more students are repeating, more they become automatically, they get this automaticity in providing correct sentences, correct utterances. Well, next method, well, very briefly, I told you that it's very briefly will be, we have a whole language. Well, whole language appeared as a necessity of include all language skills. As you could see in grammar translation, it was just emphasis on reading, and direct method it was emphasis exclusively on speaking, and audiolingual it was again just practically speaking and listening. Some other language skills like reading and writing were put aside, and it's not correct, because if we need to learn language in all its parts, it means that we also have to be able to read and write in that language. That's why our designers of this method, well, they said that language must be learned and taught as a whole. Well, it means that speaking, reading, writing, and all four language skills must be included and taken into consideration. And a very good element of this method, it's focus on reading. And actually, now maybe you know, if you work in private schools, you know that authorities put demand teachers to include reading also, because everybody now realized the usefulness of focus on reading skills too, because reading helps us to achieve more knowledge of vocabulary, of structures of sentences. Well, benefits of reading are many. Yeah, so now there is a tendency, a general tendency, to include reading as a mandatory part of syllabus, a mandatory part of design of course. Well, so in this method, in whole language, we have to emphasize authentic literature. Reading for comprehension is emphasized, not just like in audiolingual students where just had to be able to utter sentences, patterns, without realizing their meaning, what they mean, without thinking how sentence should be structured. It was not focused at all, but here it's reading for comprehension. Well, so not only to be able to know vocabulary, but understand what students are reading in all its implications. Well, structures, vocabulary, paragraph organizing, etc. And the main point was to make reading attractive, so text should be chosen of high interest and not just something abstract, but something according to age and interest of students. Well, and writing, it's another main element of this whole language approach or method. It's writing should be done for real audience, not like in a grammar translation, just translate in written form sentences for teachers to correct and check. Yeah, but here writing is done with the purpose to have a concrete audience in mind. What it means that students are asked to write to write, for example, letters or projects for their classmates, for another group, for example, something who is concrete, concretely is going to read and analyze this. So it's it has purpose in sense for students to do, to perform this task. Well, and emphasizing again that it's integration of four skills: reading, writing, listening, and speaking. Here we have main principles. Well, and more. And as you can see, it's a student-centered approach. In difference to direct method, it's teacher-centered, or audiolingual, it's also teacher-centered. But this whole language approach is student-centered because students they choose. Into material they would like to read. They even may suggest teacher what they would like to choose for reading activity, and suggest topics for writing activities. So in teacher, for example, a teacher's role is just a facilitator of a process, and he is an active participant in the during the class, and he should create a supportive and collaborative climate for students to be able to open themselves completely and display their creativity. So students also should consider themselves as collaborators with classmates and with the teacher. So it's a like integrating process, all participants, all students. Well, and here you have some classroom activities that can be done applying this method, like writing conferences, students made books, story writing, dialogues, journals, student made books, etc., etc. So it just depends on your creativity or creativity of your students, what they would like to write. And in this slide, you have some negative points of this method. So, well, it's seen that anti-direct teaching, anti-skills, and anti-materials. Why? Because all things come together. For example, in direct method, it was just speaking and listening emphasized. But here we have all four skills together. That's why some pedagogues or some opponents of this method, they criticize for being anti-skills, because according to those people, each method should be organized, for example, only around practicing speaking skills, or only around writing skills, etc. But here in this method, all things are, all skills are together. So for some people, they didn't consider it like practical, this method, or anti-materials, because materials can be brought by teacher, by students, a real world material, what it means, real books, real newspapers, magazines, etc. And so some people may criticize that, no, if my students still don't have a range vocabulary, don't have that much vocabulary storage in their brain, so how they can be how they can read this book, it's useless. Well, but you may understand that instead of simplifying the material, teachers should simplify the task. For example, you may bring authentic material like a book or a magazine or newspaper or article, and ask your students, for example, to find words they do know, words they do understand. Instead of simplifying material, you can simplify the task. Yeah, so But at the same time, this authentic material represents a good advantage for students because this is their opportunity to see how real language is its form, how it is. Oof. Next method is communicative language teaching. Communicative. Well, it's it appeared in Britain in late 60s. Here you have some elements of its theory. So it starts from a theory of language as communication. So again, some positive points were taken from the previous method and adopted by the subsequent method, as I already said. So communication is still emphasized greatly. Well, and goal is develop communicative competence. Well, and language is a system of expression of meanings. Well, and primary function is allow interaction and communication. So a focus is on communicative contextual factors. And communicative acts underline ability to use language for different purposes. This is a kind of different that language is seen using in bearing in mind this its purpose of language. What it means that in different situations we can use language differently. For example, if it's a formal situation, I have to use or a student has to use a set of established phrases appropriate for formal situation. For example, hello, how are you, how do you do, it's okay. But if for example, formal language is used at level of a very informal communication, so this kind of expressions would be seen as something hilarious or absurd. For example, if you say to your close friends, how do you do? Yeah. Or instead, if you say to an authority, howdy. So it also is not appropriate. So this is a purpose. According to purposes, language should be used. So this is a new that appeared in a language teaching. And with this regard, I'd like to mention that a British linguist, Wilkins, he proposed definitions of a language. Well, he said language teaching and learning can be organized bearing in mind two big categories of notions. So first is notional category. What it means that teacher should organize teaching around this notion that you have in your slide. For example, time. When I teach time, it means that I have to teach numerals. Yes, I have to teach some preposition after quarter two, for example, or sequence, now, later, after that, before, etc. Quantity, how much, how many. Well, and location, places, and preposition also, and frequency, how often, frequently, rarely, never, seldom, etc. Yeah, and another big category of how language should be split. Another category is function. Well, so when your students already know some terminology or numerals or words, how we can organize sequence, for example, organizing sequence, we need to know grammar tenses. Yeah. So if I want to speak about present events, I use present tense, past events, past tense, consequently, future, and so on. Well, and but also, as I already mentioned, that something that was new in this method, it's that language is taught according to its purpose, its communicative function. For example, request. How you should make a request. Yeah, so set of phrases like, would you be so kind? Is it possible if I ask you, etc., etc.? Yeah, or how to make denials, offers, and complaints. Yeah, so language, I make a kind of a summary that language teaching was split into big groups. First is notional categories and functional categories. Yeah, so and teaching was organized around these two big portions. Well, and here we have some strengths. Well, so students need to know how to use language according to situation. Well, and emphasis was placed on exposure to language. And also teachers should remind students that students learn language not only just to know this language, but also to know how to use it. According to which situation, according to situation, students have to choose from all the set of phrases, they have to choose appropriate one. If it's formal situation, they have to use formal set of phrases, etc. Yeah, well, and here you have some more principles: communication principle, activities that involve real communication promote learning, etc., and task principle and meaningful principle. Meaningful principle is very important, that language that is meaningful to learner supports learning process. What it means, if students understand why they use this activity, why they learn this particular portion of language or vocabulary, so the learning will be successful. Example, if you tell your students, okay, today you are going to learn parts of helicopter, for example, with all this technical vocabulary. Yeah, okay, students might be excited, especially maybe boys, to learn all these parts of helicopter. That's all. But next class, teacher comes and say, okay, and today we're going to speak about something different. And students will ask, teacher, but what about this vocabulary? Last class we practiced about parts of helicopter. When are we going to construct our helicopter? Yeah, so this is an example how task is should be meaningful and language should be meaningful. If your students are asked to learn this specific portion of vocabulary, so teacher should apply this knowledge and create activities and opportunities for students to use that language that they learn, to create a sense of meaning. Well, so here you have some more characteristics. It's a learning, it's a student-centered approach. Here you have integration of foreign language skills also, and here you have some more a characteristic. I think I have to go a little bit faster. I have to skip this part, and you can analyze this part later. When we finish this presentation, you will have access to it. I am going to upload it, and you will analyze it in more tranquil form. And activities, well, they are unlimited. Speaking, they are unlimited. You can use a lot of activities. Well, and activities should be selected according to how well students engage the students, how these activities engage students in meaningful and authentic language. What I explained with example of helicopter. Yeah. So if you are going to use this knowledge that students have, you must be sure that students have opportunity to use this knowledge in next class. Well, a kind of class activities, they are divided into types. Well, first, the task-based. Usually, in all textbooks, we already have already made activities, so teacher simply have simply can use these activities. They are called task-based. They already included in textbooks. And another, which is, well, to my mind, of course, so-called social interaction activities. Well, social interaction activities, as you can understand, they are much more attractive for students. Conversation and discussion sessions, debates, dialogue, simulations, etc., etc. Games, role plays, and all this that students may show their creativity. Well, and students have to, it's a, as I already mentioned, it's a learner-centered method, so students have to interact with each other. And successful communication is achieved collaboratively, and teacher just facilitates communication between all the participants. Well, then next method we have, it's cooperative language teaching. Cooperative language teaching, well, it's one of tendencies nowadays to integrate students in cooperation and make them work together. Well, it's I already got acquainted with your information that you kindly posted in forum. Well, so all of you are my colleagues, so you are a teacher. So we just, it's not necessarily for you to repeat that when your students feel at ease in class, so they produce more, so learning and teaching process is more efficient. So of course, when students work in groups, well, they feel more comfortable. They are not afraid of speaking in front of classmates, not afraid of making mistakes, maybe in pronunciation, etc., etc. Well, and at the same time, it's very beneficial for teacher too, because teacher in this moment when students are working in groups, teacher can monitor this process and see, can realize what must be reinforced, etc., etc. So cooperation is nowadays is very widely used method or part of a class. Well, so main point is that emphasis on maximum use of cooperative activities. Well, and students are work in groups or in pairs. It's very frequently nowadays again. Well, some objectives you see, it's increase cooperation rather than competition, develop critical thinking skills, because when teacher just offers the material, students just have to swallow, well, figuratively speaking, well, to swallow this information the teacher says. But when the students work in group, well, sometimes, as in my teaching experience, I am simply amazed by creativity of students. I say, well, my goodness, I have to sit together with them to learn from my students how efficient they are. Well, because it's an opportunity for students to make their imagination fly, and this is very beneficial for this learning process. Well, so here we have some goals of cooperative language learning is provide opportunities for second language learning through the use of interactive group work. It's again, it's a repetition of what I have said. And focus of focus attention on language structures, particular lexical item, and communication through interactive tasks. Well, and provide opportunities for students to develop successful learning and communication strategies and create positive, affective climate. This is very important. This is what I already emphasized. When your environment in your class is friendly, yeah, so learning occurs easily and productively. But when students are under kind of afraid or nervous, well, so it's not beneficial for students, no, not for a teacher either. Well, so here you have some theory of learning that I prepared for you. Cooperation, according to Lev Vygotsky, it's a Russian pedagogue, was very famous, and Jean Piaget, it's French pedagogue. They both stated the stress, the central, they both stressed the central role of social interaction and learning. Well, when you don't understand something, who do you ask first? Probably first you ask your peer, not your teacher. Or it's, if we speak about education, but in life, for example, if you don't understand something, what do? You go to the you search in the internet, or immediately go to the library to find some information, or probably you ask someone who is close to you. Well, this is what I want to say, that it's a cooperation. So first, you know that human beings were social beings, yeah. So we tend first to ask someone who is next to us or who is close. Well, so it's a cooperation. So this is was taken as a basis for this method. Well, here we have some advantages. There are many. I just emphasized some of them, like increased frequency and variety of practice through interaction, possibility for development or use of language in ways that support cognitive development, increased language skills, etc., etc. And of course, integration of language with content-based instruction. Well, And so the basis of this method is cooperation, working in groups. And teacher, before organizing students in group, must think about what kind of tasks I'm going to give my students. Well, and tasks can be divided for one group or for several groups. If it's for one group, so all students work on the same material. Teachers direct presentations of the task. Everyone should know what to do in group, and any group member should know the answer and be ready to report and explain. I would like to make a parenthesis here and explain. Well, of course, I'm sure that you are efficient teachers, all of you, and you know that, for example, when you make your students work in group, so you tell your student, please be ready that any member of your group can then report results of group work back to your class. Not only we have five students, only Juanito is working hard, and Juanito is the one who is going then to report, and the rest four members of a group just passively texting with the classmates. Meanwhile, Juanito is doing the rest of the work. No. So when we have this kind of a group, when we have this group work, so all members of a group must be members, active members of a group. Not only one, but all of them. And all of them, any of integrants of the group should be ready to report back the results of group work. Well, and when we have different groups in the same class, what it means that groups work in different topics. We have different groups. For example, we have five groups in class, and group one is working on topic number one. Group two is working on topic number two, and so on. Well, so students may use different sources for research, may use different techniques, but what is necessary here that each group then should present work for the whole class, not for the teacher. Why? Because it will be highly motivating for students to work and realize that this effort must be will be appreciated not only by teacher when teacher goes home, takes all this group work report back and checks at home. No, but when when the group work is over, then members of a group report back for the rest of the classmates. Actually, this is we all are practicing in our classes, and here in UTPL also we do this. It's when we have this well, this word is left of my mind. At the beginning of each semester, we have this practicing, this meetings, and when students are asked to work in groups, and then each group reports back. So it's a sense of fulfillment. Sense of fulfillment. This is very important that students should have enough time for reporting back the result of group. Group effort. Well, and here we have some types of learning and teaching activities like exchange of opinions, sharing information, discussing group projects, pair work, etc., etc., etc. This information that you see in your slides. Well, and learner is a member of a group. It's, as you can conclude, it's a learner-centered approach. Well, a learner is a member of a group, and teacher simply has to create well-organized learning environment and establishes goals, of course, plans and structure tasks. Well, in this regard, I'd like to emphasize that teachers should carefully select topics or even give more autonomy to your students and ask students to offer topics for class discussion. Well, it even be more interesting. Well, and the next method is content-based. Content-based instruction is the last method I prepared for today's presentation. Well, content-based instruction, as you can, as you already, I hope that you already scrolled checked your book and you already maybe know that this method is suitable not for beginners, not for intermediates, but it's used for advanced students. And actually, this method is used in educational establishments. What it means that in some subjects are taught in a target language. Well, and this demands excellent mastery on the part of a teacher, not only of a language, but in a content, a course content. For example, if a history class is given in English, so it means the teacher must be knowledgeable enough not only in English but in the history too. And if it's a class of geography, the same. Together with a good knowledge, good master of a language, teacher should be quite knowledgeable in geography topics also. So it's a content-based instruction. So teaching is in learning is organized around specific contents, and this it's very demanding. This to use this method is very demanding, demanding for teachers, demanding for students. Well. And so this approach, teaching is organized around the content of information the students will acquire rather than around a linguistic type or syllables. So topic is chosen and learning is organized around this. Or if it is a subject like a history or like a literature, for example, or like any other topic, or even in some schools mathematics is taught in English. I think it's not new for those who work in private institutions. They may know that, wow, it's kind of very tough, very demanding. Well, so main point, that language is used for specific purposes, academic, vocational, social, etc. And learning is believed to be more motivating when students use topics of a particular interest. Well, so it goes together, well, I would say hand in hand with a whole language approach. Well, you remember in the whole language approach, reading and writing was emphasized, and students were allowed to choose some topics or books or literature according to their interest. The same is here. Students are given some kind of autonomy to select topics of particular interest to discuss. Well, and here you have objectives: activate and develop existing English language skills. This is proves what I already said, that this method is mostly suitable for advanced rather than for beginner learner. Well, then next objective is acquire learning skills and strategies that could be applied in future language development opportunities, and develop general academic skills applicable to university studies in all subject areas. And this is what I already mentioned, what I have already mentioned, that for example, that if some subjects are taught in this in target language, and when students graduate from this educational establishment, so it will be easier for these students to study any master's program or study abroad. They will be accustomed to learn not only English as English, yeah, but learn different subjects in English language. Yeah, so this is what is important to emphasize in this method. Well, and of course, it can broaden students' understanding of English-speaking peoples. Peoples is not a mistake. Peoples refers to nations, yeah? Nations that use English as a first or a second language. Well, so approach of this method, like you have in your screen, that's people learn a second language more successfully when they use language as a means of acquiring information, and it reflects better reflects learners' needs for learning a second language and prepare students for academic studies, what I have already mentioned. Well, and language is text and discourse based. It involves the study of textual and discourse structure or written text, letters, reports, essays, descriptions, books, chapters, etc. Well, and this can help them in mastery of a target language. Well, and also this method emphasizes usage of for all four skills, or four skills are integrated: speaking, reading, writing, and listening. Yeah, so they are come together. Well, and some class activities Vocabulary building, of course, if for example, if it's a geography class but in English, students' knowledge of vocabulary will increase greatly, immensely. If it's for example, a literature study in target language, well, it's needless to say, well, how students will, how the knowledge will be enriched by be exposed to authentic literature. And of course, study skills, because not only students will learn English itself, but content of a subject. So study skills also are increased and focused. Well, and language skill improvement in general. Well, teacher must be a good knower of subject besides of English, as I have already mentioned, and he should select or adapt authentic material for class use. And since this method is learner-centered, so students also are sources of content and active participants in the selection of topic. So materials, here you have some authentic texts, subjects, textbooks, articles related to the subject, and everything that must be used to expand, deepen, increase a student's knowledge of English, of both English and subject. Well, and materials could be adapted or modified to achieve maximum comprehensibility. People, I appreciate very, very much your attention, your patience, and yeah, I appreciate very, very much your attention, your patience, and that you, well, could send this long explanation, very brief. Well, for time's sake reasons, I did not include multiple intelligences method, but I suppose that you have knowledge of this, and in case you need my extra explanation, well, you know, you can feel free and contact me anytime. Well, I will try to find this time to answer and to help you with the doubts. Well, if you have some questions, you can ask, but I hope that I will be able to answer all your questions. Yeah, so please go ahead.
Good afternoon, Nina.
Good afternoon.
It's Anna, and I am from Cuenca, and I am here with some classmates. Okay. And it has been nice listening to you, and we really don't have a question, but we would like to make you a request. We would like to ask you to post the information some days in advance, like, for example, not only the date, but also like the topic. This is very important, like with the other two courses that we
took. I understand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So please, that's very important to us, because we need to do all the reading, the planning, because we work. So we would really appreciate you doing this. Thank you. That is a request.
Thank you very much for your request, for being brave to request this in front of everybody. Well, and with this regard, I would like to emphasize, as you already know, I am invited. I was peacefully working on my guide, my applied linguistic guide that we are going to work in the next cycle, if God will. Yeah. So in one of these days, Gina came and said, Nina, Elsa gave birth, please help us. I said, okay, what are you expect me to do? So you have to give a video conference. Okay, well, I'm going to do video conference. No, but not only that, you have to be like a teacher of this class. So it came from one moment to another. That's why it was so chaotic for me. I was working so peacefully, concentrating on my applied linguistic guide. Well, and then this portion of work came over. Wow. So this is the reason, people, I apologize greatly, but please, I at the same time, I ask you a little bit of comprehension that it's, for me, it was unexpected. Well, you know that tomorrow we have a chat, but from now on, I promise, I promise to try to be more, to plan in advance. Well, it's just because of the beginning, it was unexpectedly asked, wow, at once to do something. That's why we have a so kind of chaotic beginning of this course. This is the main reason, and I apologize, but please understand it's not my fault completely. Well, so now
we understand you, Nina, okay. And thank you very much for your understanding too. And
okay,
thanks a lot.
Okay, so I hope that in January we are going to work normally with all activities anticipated beforehand. Well, okay, more questions?
More.
Okay, well, if you don't have questions, so thank you very much for your patience, for coming, for taking your time, maybe sacrificing your time to come. Well, and I'm going to upload this presentation to Eva, so it will be available for you, and then you can analyze it in a more tranquil way, as I already said, analyzing slide by slide. Maybe I was speaking too fast. Well, but you will have chance to reread it again and analyze. And again, if you have questions, well, I'm here and I will try to do my best to answer all your questions. Okay? Well, so thank you very much. It's a pleasure for me. Well, and I hope that everything will be fine.